It's showtime. Hello, good evening, and welcome to the 23 podcast show, episode number 11, with myself, your host, David Blairr. And tonight I am joined by
Peter Johnston.
Peter Johnston, who is through in Bathgate at the moment. In
That's right.
The wester of Lothian.
Mm-hmm.
How's it out there today?
Hmm?
How's the weather out there today?
Oh, it's crazy. Like, we've just been watching. My dad's got a tent up in the back garden. Like, he's got some stuff in it, and I'm just waiting for it to fly away. But it's not done right yet. It's been that's the only excitement happening today.
it's pretty wild here. My isolation station is in Cranston in North Lanarkshire. So it's been wild. It's been wet. It's been windy. It's taken a wee turn. We have had a decent run on lockdown of lovely weather, which seems quite Sod's Law, really, about it all as well, doesn't it? So thank you, everybody, for tuning in. At this stage of the show, we have just went live on our 23 Universe and Yellow Movement Facebook pages, also on our 23 Universe YouTube and Twitch channels. Got quite a few viewers on just now. Thank you for joining us. Give us a wee shout out in the comments. Let us know what you're on, where you're watching, who you're with, what you're drinking. Just going to quickly go to our phones just now just to share the link on my personal timeline. We're going to be playing Peter's Yoko Ono song later. I've been playing his Spotify, which we'll also share in the comments in a bit. But I've had that wee Yoko Ono melody. It's been an earworm in my head all day. I love it.
Thanks.
We'll talk about that as well. Well, I started a Yoko Ono section. That was like you basically inspired me, because I think I'd said to you anyway what I've been sitting. I've been sitting staring at our famous grapefruit book, a book of instructions and drawings. So I've started a new feature, which is I'm just going to read one of our instructions each show. Right, so we're live now. Blah, 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 blah.
These are tweets.
No, this is just going on my own personal Facebook timeline. Because it's
tweets are just wild. Yoko Ono's tweets are wild.
Oh, Yoko's tweets.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. Tell us about them just whilst I'm quickly doing this.
I think, like, when I was younger, I used to think they were hilarious. But now maybe I appreciate them more, and I appreciate Yoko Ono more. They're like, imagine just stuff like imagine a river or stuff like that, like just strange, like really out there tweets, like wee haikus almost, like and they're just brilliant, probably the best Twitter, you know, Yoko Ono's Twitter.
Is she just Yoko Ono, or is it Yoko Ono official?
I'm not sure what it is. I think it's probably Yoko Ono official.
Right, okay. We can maybe do some live tweeting. We'll send her your Yoko Ono video. We'll see if we can pull her into the 23 universe.
Yeah.
See if she's up for that. Right. I'm just going into the event now as well. Okay. And get that shared. So our introduction was made by some mutual friends who were on a previous show.
Yeah.
Neil McKenzie and Rachel Ann Clark. So tell us, how do you know them?
Well, I used to live in the flat next door to them. And I was just sort of been collaborating with Neil ever since. I've got to know Rachel since then. And I've actually had a strange connection with Rachel, because I worked as a tour guide in Fairfield Shipyard. And she worked in the shipyard as well, in one of the offices, and we'd see each other every day, but we never realized that we knew each other outside of work. But I missed that flat, because you should just chap on their window and go in for a cup of coffee. But I've made music videos with those guys. I've done all sorts of cool things. So Well, yeah, they're good
you
guys,
may.
great people.
They definitely are. I shout out. Keep it creative. Glasgow Roots Review, Fanny Business, the Salon. They're involved in some amazing things. What I'll actually just do to start with is I will give their. That was episode 8. I'm just going to give the YouTube link for their show. We share there in the comments. Oh, Peter, I've lost you. You're away, mate. I don't know what you've pressed. Well, until he comes back, we'll have a wee round up around the comments. Who've we got on with us? SoulCal, vote for Pedro. I'll bring this back in hopefully when he returns very soon. Oh, there he's there. He's back. I lost
Sorry,
you. No bother. I was just saying, well, we'll just quickly go through a few comments came in there. Give a wee shout out. There's SoulCal, vote for Pedro. Do you know SoulCal?
Thanks, Calvin. Yeah, I know Calvin very
Aye.
Well.
He's just started a new radio station project.
Mm-hmm.
He'd sent me a link for that earlier on. Maybe he'd sent yourself a link as well. How do you know him?
I met him at Tea in the Park, funnily enough.
Really?
And this was like 2012, no, 2013 maybe, and we've been in touch ever since.
Brilliant.
And all those Tea in the Park guys.
Just camping next to one another, or did you just meet
yeah,
in Slanty
right,
and ask one another for a drink of water?
No, we were just camping next to each other, yeah.
Do you remember what zone? I was always Red 9.
I have no idea. I was only there once, and I think it was the last year before it all went downhill for them. This was a good year, actually. This was a good year.
Was it the last site, the Strathallan one, or Balado?
No, it was Balado.
Balado, right.
Yeah.
So that was, I think they did two at Strathallan. We were lucky. Actually, that was one of the places where I met Neil backstage. Neil was doing some filming when we played the very last one in the tea break stage. I just found Calvin had sent me a message. So he started a new radio show. It's called GFM Radio. So one of the things, if you're a regular tuner into the show, thanks very much for coming back. If you're new here, coming in to... get involved with the chat with Peter. One of the things that we're all obviously very keen on is promoting and sharing anything creative, anything you want us to give a shout out, people doing good things, community causes, all of that kind of thing. So we are all in lockdown at the moment. We're having to up our creative game and keep our minds engaged, keep ourselves as mentally and physically active as possible. It's obviously very important. We are going to be talking about one of the topics being Vincent van Gogh as well. But this week is the Mental Health Awareness Week. The focus is on kindness. Kindness isn't just for Mental Health Awareness Week, though. It's obviously something that we should be, that should be our default all year round. And Vincent van Gogh obviously has a history with mental health. And we'll discuss more about that. Mm-hmm. So I'm all about kindness, sharing what other people are doing, giving them shout outs. So I'm just going to give Calvin's new radio station a wee share there in the comments. So if we're doing that, if you wouldn't mind, just please give it a wee click on, give them a wee link, follow and see what they're doing, find the others. You never know what can happen from a random connection. There's Gaz Penders, Stevie Boy, thanks for coming back, Gaz. Agley Rodriguez, drinking an oyster milkshake.
Hello, my pal Agley.
Right.
Hiya.
Where are they from?
Edinburgh, via Venezuela.
Buenos noches or buenas tardes, whatever. Que hora is where you are. Hablas español, Pedro? No?
Niet.
I learned a bit of Spanish by living in Costa Rica. Then went back to Peru a couple of years after that and was pleased that I could still get by. So, ¿cómo estás, Agley? ¿Todo bien? Rachel Ann. Oh, there's Rachel Ann. Hiya, Rachel Ann.
Hi, Rachel.
Fiona
Morgan. Hi, Fiona.
Hi, Peter. Hi, Fiona. Thanks for joining us. Sharon, I had excitement. Seen Irvin Welsh DJing. He looked like he had no natural rhythm, yet he was dancing happy. Made my day. That's what we like to hear. I was on a virtual rave earlier on for Lady Mustard's 40th, so we were all very much, everyone's happy, everyone's smiling. No one there was sad anymore. we're all doing the best we can. There's Fiona, or she's tagged some pals. Good on you. There's Neil. Thanks for coming back, Neil. Good man. SoCal. Good man, good man, good man. Smashing cheers, you're welcome, mate. There's Kate Beaton. Hi, Kate. Stephen Martin tuning in. Irie, one love, brother, one love. So, you're a man who's involved with quite a few creative projects, so why don't you, let's tell the 23 universe all about yourself.
Well, I'm Peter Johnson, I'm a musician. And I've always been very creative. I think music was my first sort of creative outlet. I also did filmmaking when I was younger as well. And I always thought, oh, how can I do filmmaking and music? And I'm only given half and half to each thing. But then I thought, well, I don't think that anymore. Whatever creative talent you have, you can utilize it for everything else. So I make my own artwork. I make my own music videos. And it's all great. I make more merchandise as well.
Brilliant. Yeah. So what was it's obviously it's a bit of a cliche question, I suppose, but what's your first memories of music, or how did you first discover music or even art, or like where was the creative spark, or what was the creative catalyst for yourself?
Well, the first thing I did was I made a short film, me and my friend Gareth and my wee brother, we made a short film called The Deadly Dyson. I got a camcorder for my birthday when I was like 13, and it was just like a sort of like Wallace and Gromit type of thing about a Hoover that goes about killing the family, and I had like a pipe cleaner. And right. I showed it in front of the class and everyone really liked it. And my art teacher said to me, you're an artist. And that was just like the best compliment. So that was my first creative thing, was that.
Right.
And then I wanted to be cool, so I learned the guitar. That's it. There's more shallow reasons to get into music, really.
there definitely are. Do you remember the first chords or the first song that you were trying to learn or you did learn on the guitar?
It was Half the World Away by Oasis was the first one I learned.
Good shout.
CF.
Right.
Yeah.
So just to try and get a parallel here between music and culture and stuff like that, that would have been overlapping between us. I'm 42. What age are you yourself?
26.
26, right, okay. So, were Oasis finished when?
No, I saw Oasis on my last tour, the very last tour in Murrayfield, and the crowd could sing better.
I was there as well. I think that was where the Seahorses supporting that day.
I think Las Vegas were somewhere in the belt.
Was it Las Vegas?
And I can't remember well.
I think they might have been the opening act. I think that was still in the drinking years for me, so the memories are a little bit patchy. I chucked the booze 11 years, 1 month, and 18 days ago. So I'd had my fill, which coincided actually from when probably I discovered Oasis, really. Cigarettes and alcohol, but without the cigarettes, but drugs instead of the cigarettes, but...
Yeah,
we all go through those phases when we're growing up. Oasis, like the Beatles, I had quite a few early loves. My earliest music memory is also my earliest memory. Full stop. And I was in my gran and granda's in Mount Ellen when my uncle John, he still lived there. It's my dad's wee brother, and he was obviously like right into his music. He was a young guy. And he was playing the Human League, Don't You Want Me, on 7-inch.
Yeah.
So this was in 1981, and I just have this very vivid memory, which is linked to that song, of kicking a balloon against the hall wall. It's just soundtracked to the Human League. But music then was an omnipresent presence throughout the rest of my life. My big brother Martin, shout out to Martin if you're watching, he's 4 years older than me, so I was luckily being introduced to a lot of like really cool music through him. And then I would probably say the first band that I proper would say that I loved, because I fancied a lassie that fancied Jim Morrison, was The Doors. And then I even grew my hair a wee bit and got a perm to try and look like Jim Morrison, but I ended up looking more like Steve McManaman because I was a Liverpool supporter. So you've been doing solo and you've been in bands as well, is that right?
Yeah, I've been in bands and I enjoy being in. I've had some fun in a band with Ryan, who I think is watching. Ryan Morecom and other people in the band. And it was just great. It's great to go on stage and feel like you're in a gang. I feel like we're in a gang when we're in the band. But organising a band and organising practice is just such a headache, because I'm sure you know, with 11 people in the band, you know. Right. But there is something nice about being in a gang, really.
It's great when it works. It's great being in a band when it works and you've got that chemistry. And you get on stage and everybody's singing from the same page. Obviously, bands come and go anyway, don't they? Like, that's just the Beatles split up, as they famously say. Do you have an all time favourite band or all time favourite artist or anything? Would you say, or narrow down to a top three?
I'll tell you who my top three would be. I'm really, for me, anytime I say, I wish I'd written that song, and I fantasize myself writing that song, that's when I know I really love that band. So I love Kirsty MacColl. Kirsty MacColl was my number one, you know, so she'd be that. Joni Mitchell is up there, is there. The Kinks.
Pulp, brilliant.
Courtney Barnett.
She's great.
Courtney Barnett. Yeah.
Seen her at Glasgow in the early days.
Yeah. They're my sort of go-to. And Belle and Sebastian. But like growing up, my progression was Oasis. No, it was the Beatles, Oasis, the Smiths. And then it was like Belle and Sebastian. And even though I don't listen to those bands as much anymore, they have a place in my heart.
Yeah.
You know.
They always will. It's the same with Oasis. I mean, personally, I never bought into the whole Oasis versus Blur media bullshit. And obviously, the record labels like Creation and Parlophone were in cahoots behind the scenes anyway, because they knew all PR is good PR. So the more they could occupy the front few pages of the tabloids and the FHM and Loaded and all the rest of it and blah, 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 then the more they were going to sell. Ah, exactly. Obviously, I mean, like, sadly, with a lot of cocaine involved, that did then, between certain members of both bands, reach a zenith of hatred with your man Noel saying that he wished Damon would die of AIDS, which is still fucking bang of order, no matter which way you dress it up. I don't care how much cocaine you've been taking during the 80s, that's just a cuntish thing to say. But
the music was bad as well at that time.
Oh, well, that's it. From Be Here Now, it just went downhill from there. There were some... They ended up with some decent songs on some of the albums thereafter, but it was like, with the aspirations, like Noel wrote Definitely Maybe, all the B-sides, and What's the Story, More Than Glory, like, all more or less over like a time period where that was the plan. So when they were originally called Rain after the Beatles song, and when Liam knew he was coming off his roadie with Inspiral Carpets and says, listen, our kid, do you want to come into the band? And he says, well, the only way I'm coming into the band is if, like, basically, he's called the governor for a reason, isn't he? He says, we do it my way or no way. And he's like, well, if you've got the tunes, then I'll just sing them and we'll take it from there. But all gets overblown in excess thereafter, doesn't it? Have you seen the Super Sonic documentary?
I've seen so many documentaries about them. I've kind of sickened myself when watching documentaries about them. I've not seen the more recent ones, but when I was a teenager, I had the parka and I had all that nonsense. So I don't watch the documentaries, just in case I flip back into it. Suddenly I start.
Did you have the no hairdo or the lame hairdo?
I have no idea what I had, to be honest. It was not good. I didn't have the hairline for the sort of, you know, Paul Weller hair.
Yeah.
I just had
joined the club. We're in the same club there. We're in the same club there. My big brother was a jammy bastard. Like, he actually really looked like Liam, and he used to get mistaken. What's the past tense? Anyway, we'd go out and we'd actually fucking go to Oasis gigs, and look, people, sometimes mostly very drunk, would actually think he was fucking Liam Gallagher. Now, unfortunately for him, he was shite at doing a Mancunian accent, so obviously he couldn't spin it and actually try and get away with any level. But it did make him pretty popular with the ladies, I have to say, at Oasis gigs. So, Martin had a good time with that. So, what age were you when you sort of were you in a band first or solo first?
I was in a band first, but it was just sort of like lots of bands that never played any gigs, you know?
And where was that, in Glasgow? Or
no, in Bathgate. In Bathgate. Yeah.
Right, so I'll tell you the extent of my knowledge of your sort of like your music scene out there just now. Do you know Luke Levolt?
I went to school with Luke, he's a good guy.
Right.
And Luke is Howdy as well. He's from here.
Yeah. And his brother Warren.
Warren, yeah. And Adam.
Yeah.
Adam Warrington as well.
Okay. So I mean it's there are some, yes, if you're tuning in, hello. So there are obviously some big hitters, and your woman that won, Susan Boyle. Sheafy Bathgate or Whitburn?
Susan's great. I've got a lot of love for Susan Boyle. She's a hero.
Bathgate or Whitburn she's from?
Blackburn, but we claim Blackburn. Her for us.
Right. Yeah. So are they all Blackburn,
Whitburn? Not from Bathgate either. He's from Whitburn. So.
Whitburn, right.
Yeah.
So they're all quite close to one another then, like Bathgate, Whitburn. Right, okay. And there's the Purple Orange Arts Centre
in Bathgate. Yeah.
So do you know Gail and her partner that run that?
Yeah, Michael, yeah.
Michael Matheson.
Yeah.
Actually, I wonder if they're tuning in. Shout out to Gail and Michael if they are. Lovely, lovely couple. I've been through there before. Some of the artists that I manage, John Rush, used to manage Colin Hunter as well. We went through there. Another lad called Lee McGilvery, flew the arrow.
He's my pal. Hello, Lee. I hope you're watching.
I hope you're watching as well, Lee. I'll be speaking to you soon, Lee, because I'll be wanting to get you on a future episode.
He was meant to play in my EP launch, but it was cancelled because of
all this.
The coronavirus. Yeah, it was like the first day of the coronavirus.
First day of the lockdown on the 23rd.
It was like St. Patrick's Day was meant to be. So it was like, I think it was before that. But
Tuesday
we decided
17th.
To cancel it. Yeah.
Right.
We decided to cancel it. Yeah.
Quite a few things went before that. And that's the timeline. So I've been on lockdown in my isolation station for coming up for 10 weeks tomorrow, actually, because working in the Barrowland Ballroom, it's one of the other hats that I wear. On Thursday, the 12th of March, that's when Nicola Sturgeon gave her press conference with the chief medical officer, and she said that from Monday they were advising all large gatherings of 500 or more people not to go ahead. But then that was just the first domino that fell, that was pushed, and then everything then went from there. Just give me a shout out to a few of the folks in the comments. Stephen's saying, you lads, stay safe, stay strong. That's what we're trying to do. Same to yourself, Stephen. Stephen got a Sony cam when he hit 21. He's still got the tapes. Agley from Venezuela. Donde in Venezuela? Caracas?
I said Venezuela.
Yeah. Is that, I've not got my glasses on. I can't see the picture there. Is that Agley, male or female?
Venezuela, yeah.
Is that a male or female name?
I said Venezuela. Agley.
You did. You did. I don't know. Is that a male or female name? I don't know.
It's a female. It's a woman.
Okay. Agley, Donde esta in Caracas?
Maybe Agley, actually. Agley, we pronounced your name right.
Agley. Agley, maybe. Buenas noches. Yes. Put in a phonetic spelling of your name. I think it might be Agley. If that's pronounced correctly, let us know. So the EP launch, was that for Yoko Ono?
Yeah, that was for Yoko Ono, yeah. And we had, we're meant to have Hayley Beavis, who I think is great. If you ask me who my favourite artists are, Hayley Beavis is one of them also. Hayley Beavis is fantastic. Looks fantastic. Yeah, Through the Arrow is great as well. It was meant to be Through the Arrow, Hayley Beavis, and myself for the EP launch.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm going to give Nicky's tuning in. Hello, Peter.
Oh, Nicky Fitzpatrick.
Hi, Nicky. Thanks for joining us in the 23 Universe. I've just given Haley's Facebook page a share in there, and I'm going to give Lee Flew the Arrow. So where was the EP launch?
It was meant to be in the Glad Cafe, and hopefully when this is all over, right, it will be in the Glad Cafe. Sometime, okay, maybe in the winter, I suppose, really.
Can you say, or have you put a pencil on a future date and you're just
waiting? I have paid a deposit, so it will happen. Right.
The Glad Cafe is a cracking venue. There was actually a BBC coronavirus special the other night, because they came in, they did an interview with our bar manager, Swifty. Shout out to Swifty if you're watching. They interviewed him in the empty ballroom, socially distanced, of course. And it broke my heart, man. It really did, just kind of just hitting home. The enormity of all of this. But what was I going to say? They also interviewed Rachel Curry from the Glad Cafe. Is that her name?
I'm not sure.
I think it's a woman that owns
it. Have they stayed open? Have they managed to stay open to some level?
Good question. I don't know. It showed just like some pictures of the venue. What I do know is through Luke Gibson started that sofa phone sing along with and obviously got the backing with Luke Lavolpe and lots of other amazing people. Got onto the gigs in Scotland and the King Tut's Wawa Hut Facebook pages, had a massive reach, got like Kyle Faulkner and loads of people involved in playing in it. I ended up doing like my own research and watching some more videos from people from the Music Venue Trust. Now, the Music Venue Trust has about 750 plus members throughout the UK, and they had said that the over 500 of them were an immediate threat of not being able to reopen.
I can believe it.
If they don't get any help. So I will, as we're talking, people that I want you to help and support as well, I'll be sharing their Facebook links in the comments. So I've just given the Music Venue Trust a share as well. There's lots of fundraising gigs going on. I mean, some venues, people are in the position to help out and donate. We need to really rally around as communities and protect our local venues. Otherwise, well, we're not going to have places to go and enjoy music again.
And
record shops as well, yeah. So Record Store Day was postponed from the 20th of April, I think. It was then postponed. They pushed it back to the 20th of June. Then when they realised that wasn't going to happen either, they've now decided to put it over three different Saturdays. I think it's going to be September, October, November, which will kind of lead up to Black Friday. But Record Store Day, I've been involved in that. You were mentioning you were at Love Music Glasgow for one of them, weren't you?
Mm-hmm, I saw you guys. I think that was my very first Record Store Day. I queued up super early. I queued up like crazy early. And I got myself a red vinyl Joe Strummer singing. I was the singer. Because the Pogues did a tour without Shane McGowan, and they had Joe Strummer play. And I got that on vinyl, red vinyl. I queued up all morning. I got it. It was great. And you guys were playing. I've still got that. I still play it regularly. I love that record.
Was that the one where we were actually crowd surfing inside Love Music? Or was it when it was...
I just remember you guys being outside with the trumpets and stuff like that and the yellow...
Aye. Because then there was also... once it got a wee bit too big for inside the venue, they took over upstairs in Dow's. And that's where they would put music on, just so they could like leave some space for people just to browse and obviously buy whatever they wanted to buy. Record Store, I mean, it's like Christmas Day for the music industry, Record Store Day. So I'm just going to give the Love Music Glasgow a wee share as well. So are your Yoko Ono EP, are you just postponing the full EP launch until...
No, I'm just going to... I think we'll probably do something else. You know, I'm going to write a whole new EP and launch that one instead. But I'm still selling the EPs online, which I'll show you a copy, hand-printed. Yoko Ono. Got another one here.
Did you send me your Bandcamp link?
Yeah, I have. I've sent that over. Yeah, these are all hand printed. And I was doing an art course at Tramway.
Got it.
I need to be busy sometimes, so I'd make EPs in my meantime out of vinyl print and vinyl cuts. So that's them.
Okay. I think we could have a wee musical interlude very shortly, and we'll play the video if that's okay with yourself.
Sure thing. And this was with Neil. Yep. This video was with Neil McKenzie.
Brilliant.
And we'll talk about it a little bit more after it, I suppose.
Yeah, sure. I'm just going to share your Bandcamp link in there. So please, if I'm sure you're going to enjoy this song. It's a great song. And you can buy it from Peter's Bandcamp direct, support the artist. So I'm just giving that a wee share in the comments as well. And I'll give a shout out to Steph. You know Steph as well then, I take it?
I know Steph. She's from West Lothian.
Yeah.
Happy days in Ireland. Remember we went on holiday together, Steph, on Tackle Island? We had so much fun, didn't we? Those were the days.
What's the sort of population-wise of your community, would you say?
I think it's 25,000.
Right.
But it seems smaller because everyone's related to everybody. Like you don't want to slag anyone off because everyone's related. Everyone knows everybody, you know.
Same way. Well, the only people we slag off on this show, a couple of things just to show you. Regular viewers will know I bring up the 23 podcast show is sponsored by Dr. Timothy Leary. That's the only advert, really. I call it an advert. Just think for yourself, question authority, very important.
Yeah.
And we do have an open forum for slagging the Tories. So yeah. Fuck the Tories. I've got friends and family, Lady Mustard, she's in the front line in a COVID ward in the Glasgow Infirmary, and what they've done is absolutely terrible. So thank you for tuning in, Steph. missing you obviously at our Dijon gigs. You and Lorna, hopefully see you again sometime soon. Just give a wee shout out there before Aglaé Caracas. She loves Scotland. Scotland is a great city. Yes. Oh, she said in Edinburgh. Edinburgh is a nice city. Peter, your music is amazing, she's saying. Thank you very much for tuning in.
Thank you,
bro. Like him, fun, cute, funny, and nice. Oh, that's lovely. This is Neil looking for a video camera emoji. right, so just before we share the or we watch together the Yoko Ono video, it was made by Neil McKenzie and Rachel Ann, or just Neil on this
one? No, just me and Neil.
Okay. So Neil is an amazing company.
And some very handsome hands. We scouted the land looking for some hands. And you'll see these talented hand actors.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
Okay, so I've just given Neil's Keep It Creative Facebook page a share there in the comments. If you're watching and you're an artist, or if you're someone at home, you're wanting to get involved in any kind of creative projects whilst you're on lockdown, maybe not too sure how to go about it, Neil is most definitely your man. Get in touch with him.
Neil gets shit done.
He does. Neil makes things happen, definitely. Yoko, wish to be as talented as Peter. Oh, come on, you can't hate Yoko. Come on.
This is the Yoko Ono fan club.
This is like we're big fans of Yoko here. Yeah.
This is a little model I made of Yoko Ono. I've made a model of Yoko Ono like this week. Look at that. Both of us. He's got a tattoo. I've got a model of Yoko Ono.
There you go. John and Yoko are on the screen. Take that back, Aglaé. Take that back. I think, all right, Neil found the video camera emoji. That was less than 2 minutes, right? Probably. Rachel Ann played an advisory role in the editing. Shout out to Rachel Ann as well.
I'm sure that makes that final so good now.
Yeah. Excellent. I did actually, you sent me that wee picture.
Yeah.
Johnny Yoko, I love them. We'll talk about them more after that. Okay,
that's
so
Ryan and Fiona, if you're watching, I made those for you. So there you go.
Ryan and Fiona. Shout out to Ryan and Fiona. Are they from Bathgate?
Yeah, that's the modern day. I was in a band with Ryan and Fiona Yoko'd the band. Yeah. Yes, is what it is. But carry on.
The rubber chicken's not happy about that. Another 23 podcast show mascot. Okay, so I'm just going to mute myself. I'm going to mute Peter. We're going to play the Peter Johnson video for Yoko Ono. It's a lovely wee 2 minutes, 12 seconds song. Filmed in the Kelvin Grove Gallery.
Yeah.
Thought I recognised it. And it was made by Keep It Creative and Neil, some Rachel Ann edited. At the editing stage as well. Mm-hmm. So enjoy this, and we'll be back on the other side. Stick with us. Please feel free to give the Facebook link a share, start a watch party on your timeline. Let's get more people in. Peter's got loads of great music to share with us, lots of lovely stories to tell us about what he's doing with a Vincent van Gogh documentary. We're going to be talking about mental health. We're going to be talking about a lot of really good stuff and a lot of good music. So see you on the other side.
Cool. I'm going to...
You see, if I'm lucky, I'll get a girl like that. She don't make me happy, she just makes me sad. Oh oh. person she'd been with her. You stare every night. You joke about things that I don't think's right. Oh-oh. I'm not saying that she's your girl, oh no. Maybe I'm just scared of flying solo. And you're making me feel things I just don't want to know. John, we've both seen the movies and we know what went on. Oh, oh. I hope this won't be our epitaph, but I can't remember the last time that you made me laugh. Oh, oh. I'm not saying that she's your.
Oh.
And we're back. We're back. We're back. I'm not saying that she's Yoko Ono. Well, I think Ryan's got a libel claim against you for that. come on now, Ryan. There's no need for that. He was only saying it in jest. great video. Loved that. I'm just going to give it.
Ryan played bass as well. Ryan played bass in that track.
On the song. So talk us through who played what, who was your band on that song?
Oh, I had a fabulous band. I always have a fabulous musicians. I had Louisa Lukata playing on drums, who's an amazing drummer, orchestra level, but she kind of made it really, like sort of quite, you know, made it a different style, a different type of drumming than she usually does. And Ryan did the bass, and Chris Smith from Wife Model, produced it and played guitar on it, and on the actual EP we've got a cello player as well for other
nice.
Songs.
Who played the cello?
Sarah McWinney from Swampy Cello.
Right, okay.
Yeah.
Where did you record it?
We recorded it in a rehearsal space. We just got we did it in like 9 hours or something. Just sat in a day recording, very DIY, very punk, you know.
I'm all for the punk ethic. I'm also going to give Peter's Spotify a share in the comments. If you're not already following him on that, please do. If you ever want to just pop your Spotify device on mute and just leave it playing overnight for 24 hours continuously on repeat, it'll probably still only make him about 10 pence, but that's why. Get on the Bandcamp, please. Get on the Bandcamp. I'll be buying my handmade copy of Yoko Ono. It's a. Did you send me the Yoko Ono graphic by any chance? Is that one of them? No, I don't think it was.
Show
that again, please, for the universe. So you handmade all of these, you said, yeah?
Yeah, handmade all of these. Sorry.
Brilliant. There's a really amazing, well, one of my favourite just ever female singers. It's just what an incredible voice. You know Siobhan Wilson?
Yeah, I do know Siobhan Wilson, yeah.
Yeah. She was hand making her last EP, which was actually, I always get Steve Albini and Butch Vig mixed up.
Mm-hmm.
So was it Albini who produced In Utero, Nirvana's last album? I'm asking that. I've got Google right in front of me.
Yeah. I know it was one of them. I think it was one of them.
Steve Albini.
Any answers online? Any of you guys watching? Do any of you know?
It was. Yeah. They hired Steve Albini to record In Utero in a 2-week period, February 93 at Pachyderm Studio in Cannon Falls, Minnesota.
Yeah.
The music was quickly recorded within that time with few studio embellishments. Well, Siobhan's last EP. I'm on Siobhan's mailing list. It's just to talk about some other amazing singers. And she sent me an email. Well, she sent her mailing list an email just before Halloween last year.
Mm-hmm.
And she had a song called Echo Location, which she'd been inspired to write, if memory serves me right, by bats, obviously, because that's what they use to fly around and not bang into things and catch their prey. And then it was then a song within a sort of mini album called Plastic Grave. Steve Albini produced this, and that just blows my mind. Like, I love how many producers obviously don't constrain themselves within a box of, right, I'm only going to produce grunge music, for example. Because if you think going from Nirvana In Utero to one of the most angelic, ethereal, beautiful, fragile, like voices of Siobhan's to producing Plastic Grave.
I heard a funny one about that. You know Connie Plank, the sort of krautrock producer Connie Plank, who did like Noi and all these sort of like really right. sort of like, he produced Duke Ellington. Krautrock. Yeah, krautrock. He produced like Duke Ellington. Like the German, the sort of the trumpet player, like the charity shops, like I got inherited all my granddad's records, and he had loads of Duke Ellington things from the '50s, and like Connie Plank, the German producer, produced it, a lot of the stuff. That blows my mind. Yeah,
that's great.
Before he made it, like
one of the things I love most about George Martin, the fifth Beatle, is even before getting into the Beatles, he was mostly producing comedy, and he was producing Peter Sellers and Peter Cook and Dudley Moore and all of those guys as well. And I mean, some of them are just like my all time comedy heroes. I think the Peter Sellers Pink Panther movies are some of the funniest movies I've ever seen. Like, we used to come back from nights out and just pop them on, and normally Blazing Saddles as well. I think Blazing Saddles could possibly be my favourite ever comedy movie. What about yourself?
My brother asked me this yesterday and I didn't have an answer for him, and I wish I'd done more thinking about it. I would probably say, like, I'll tell you what I really think is hilarious, Zoolander.
That's good. Zoolander.
I watched that. I love watching films that are a wee bit kind of rude, that you watch your parents and it's surprisingly isn't that awkward. It's like cringe, but it's quite funny to watch something. I watched that with my mum and dad and they thought it was funny as well. The bit with the iconic massage scene. It's just a classic. I think it's an absolute classic. And the guy died. Stiller, Ben Stiller's dad, who's in it, died this week.
Did he?
Yeah.
Oh, no way.
There you go. But I wasn't quite of that. I just think that's a great film. I think it's just such a funny, so quotable.
Raise a glass to Ben's dad. To Ben's dad in Zoolander. By any chance, did you watch Borat or Bruno with your mum and dad?
No, I couldn't. I couldn't handle that. I like both of those.
I'll tell you the worst, probably the worst one that could possibly ever happen. So my granda, my papa, right, Tommy, ex-professional footballer, devoutly Catholic, wrapped to bevy, wrapped to smoking, just all through the power of God, as far as he was concerned. Each to their own. Whatever you believe, as long as it doesn't harm any other individual, is fine with me. But my grandad came. So, do you know the film? One of the earliest Ray Winston films called Scum.
Oh, in prison.
Yes, yeah. In the hostel.
I think I know the right. Scene you're thinking of. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, there's many scenes in it, but my granddad, anyway, he walked out very quickly. But I didn't know he was coming, so the only reason I was watching it in VHS was because I was home with my mate, and it was my mate who had brought the VHS round, and he went, "Oh, my big brother said this is one of the worst films of all time. Like, do you want to watch it?" And I was like, "Well, why?" My mum and dad are way out. Dad was a fireman. He was at work. Mm-hmm. My mum was out. So I just assumed it was just going to be me and him that were watching it. Would have been totally fine. But just randomly, like, my grand had been down at the bookies in Muirhead, down the main mm-hmm. street. So I thought, oh, I'll swing by. I'll go and say hello to my daughter, Jacqueline, my mum, and my grandchildren. And he comes in.
Yeah.
He comes in, and it's about 10 minutes in, and then it just gets worse. If you've seen the film Scum, then you'll know about the scene in the potting shed, and that's all I'm going to say. Mm-hmm. I don't want to bring back those memories, but my granddad was one of these like devoutly Catholic people who he wouldn't swear traditional swear words like maybe you and I, like fuck or shit or cunt or anything like that.
Yeah.
But he would say things like, "Oh, suffering Pete," or "Oh, Jesus, yeah. Mary, and Joseph."
My granddad, like, he's a right bastard, didn't he? He's got a lower voice. It's like, "What's a fucking bastard, eh?"
grandparents are cool. Grandparents,
yeah, my granddad was a Glasgow guy. The funniest one I had, my granddad was, we're watching the Athens Olympics. My granddad, you think that's enough? Yeah, that's plain enough to watch. I don't know if you remember the Olympics at Athens.
2002? 2004?
Yeah, that was racy. That was seen as racy. My granddad, that was just too much. Like, right. A bunch of like, sort of like people in leotards doing all that and triangles and stuff. And I think even the sort of idea of conceptual art just blew his mind. And it was like, turn this off. What is this? Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Aye, and then the Olympic Stadium. So that was they went to Athens because it was 100th anniversary. It was the centenary of when the first one restarted in modern times, wasn't it? Mm-hmm. I actually ended up visiting that stadium a few years after in 2007 because that's where the European Cup final was between the second one and 3 years between Liverpool and AC Milan. That's when AC Milan got their revenge on us. But
you see it from my tattoo. I'm a big Liverpool supporter. I've got family down there. It's another reason why I love the Beatles so much, and it's another reason why I love Yoko so much.
Just before we'll fire through a few more of the comments, give a shout out to those that are with us. What's the next YouTube video of yours I should line up?
How about the recent one, oil industry, the most recent oil industry. And Nikki, aye. I don't know if Nikki's still watching. Nikki, she made this video with me. So if you're still Nikki Fitzpatrick, hope you're watching.
Okay, Doc. I'll just line that up backstage just now. I was listening to that song a few times, excuse me, on Spotify as well. And damn that oil industry taking away your competition, bastards.
Yeah, exactly.
Bloody truth bastards.
I sing the truth.
Is that a true story? We'll talk about that as well.
Yeah, listen.
What's that?
Hi, hello again. Someone out there listening may know.
Right, okay. We'll keep it. Wink, 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 nod, nod. De nada, ugly. Thank you very much for tuning in. What is that in Spanish again? Muchas gracias por visitar los Univers 2023. Ryan says it was Albini. You were right. It was Albini. Nikki's still watching. So Nikki made this video.
Nikki, yeah. We had a fun day. And it was just about as windy as this in Millport when we made it. And
Millport.
What the hell are we doing? People were asking what was going on. You know, I think it added to it.
Is this on your Bandcamp as well, Peter?
It's all on the one CD. It's all on the one CD. Yeah, the whole EP.
Like he says, it was a team effort. Okay. Just to bring the Bandcamp for Peter back up in the comments again, I'll just give that a reshare just now before we share it. And there you go, peeps. It's in there. Please go on. Give Peter a wee bit of support. Buy some of his lovely music. And on that note, lovely music, we shall watch the Peter Johnson video for Oil Industry. And how long is that? 2:13. Are all of your videos 2:13?
Yep, about that. I always say to myself, yesterday's 2 minutes, and it's not better than yesterday, so why make it longer than 2 minutes? So there you go.
Yesterday being the most covered song of all time.
Yeah, that's right.
And also the first Beatles song where it was just one of them on their own.
Mm.
Beautiful, beautiful song.
There's one other Beatles song that only has guitar on it. Do you know what that Beatles song is?
Julia.
I don't know, actually. Maybe that's the one. I've got a different answer then.
Right. What was your answer?
I can't remember what it was again. I can't remember. I can tell you.
Right, because we've got...
I've just seen a face.
I've just not seen a face. It's what, sorry?
I've got bass guitar.
Oh, no. Right, okay. Is that what you're
saying? It should have been like, the question should have been, what doesn't have bass guitar?
Right. Okay.
Yeah.
I'm playing over my mind. Well, you've got the strings on that, haven't you, Eleanor Rigby? I think on the White Album, so because most of the White Album had been written when they went over to Rishikesh to visit the Maharishi Mahesh Yogi, and just had an unbelievable creative scene when they were over there. And that was when they were like, they really like split and were writing separately. And then even like John, well, Julie is obviously about his mum, who sadly was ran over by an off-duty policeman outside his home on Men Love Drive in Wilton. I've been down. I'm a total Beatles nut, man. We can talk about this if we require. Anyway, yeah. from the Beatles to Peter Johnson and Oil Industry, we'll be back in 2 and a bit minutes. If you want to go to the toilet or fill out your drink, I might actually go and make a green tea, and we'll see you on the other side.
Enjoy the song.
Yes, please do.
Told me once in RE, the night before you had a dream about me. I was too shy to reply, but I think about it nearly every day. Mary, I see on Facebook you've got engaged to a guy with a dog and a job in the oil industry. The oil industry. Oh, I could get a dog, and I could get a job in the oil industry, in the oil industry. Oh, I could get a dog, and I could get a job in the oil industry, in the oil industry. Mary, would it be too late? Remember that summer in the school trip to Enchcombe Island, and we broke away and spent the day carefree. Until the teacher who taught geography
but I chatted with Seagull after telling us to stay away. It was a happy day. Mary. Oh, I could get a dog, and I could get a job in the oil industry, in the oil industry. Oh, I could get a dog, and I could get a job in the oil industry, in the oil industry. Mary. It would be too late. So good luck with the wedding.
I love that farm animal.
When you ask musicians and composers who inspires you, one of the names that comes up time and time again is Bach.
Bach's extensive and varied collection of works have served as the inspiration for countless new pieces of music. For example, part of the melody from Bridge Over Troubled Water by Paul Simon was actually based on a Bach chorale. As Simon explained,
Quite clearly, 2 minutes, 13 seconds isn't enough to make a cup of green tea.
Really?
Are you there, not. Peter? Are you there?
Yeah.
You're back,
A cigarette. Face around enough for a cigarette. My songs are cigarette length.
Right, okay. I'm not a smoker, but...
I remember Norman McCabe. There's a poet called Norman McCabe, and he used to say that it took him the length of a cigarette to write a poem. And that's how long I take to write a song, the length of a cigarette now. Just because I can't
remember. Or do you time it now, like the length of a vape?
Well, this is it. My songs never are big ragas. They go on forever because they never end.
What flavour are you vaping?
Tobacco.
You just get a tobacco flavour, yeah?
Yeah.
Are you trying to come off fags? Is vaping the
same? Yeah, I'm trying to come off. Yeah, trying to come off them. Yeah.
Right. Do you still smoke any cigarettes?
I usually have one, like a wee treat now and again. I'll get myself, maybe have a packet at the weekend, but not normally. A special occasion.
Right. Are you more prone to having a real fag when you're pished?
Yeah, I do that. And the thing is, I won't have just the one either. And I always regret it the next day because I always feel horrible the next day. I always have a really worse hangover if I've been smoking.
I've never ever smoked. I've tried it. And I used to have a paper run when I was younger, but one of the biggest round, you know, the schemes here. And my pals convinced me when I was maybe about 13 or something to steal a packet of cigarettes from the newsagents where I got the newspapers from. Mm-hmm. Now, in my naivety and also my loose understanding...
This is a sad story already.
It's not really. It's got a happy ending for me because I ended up not smoking from it, but my loose understanding of capitalism at the time made me believe that the most expensive cigarettes would probably be the best ones. So I thought, if we're going to attempt smoking for the first time, we may as well just go for the premium product. So I stole a packet of, do you know the cigarette San Moritz?
No, I don't. I'll tell you my best cigarettes. I'll tell you my favourite cigarettes. Carry on.
Okay. Well, San Moritz are a menthol cigarette, and it was a weird look. It was a long packet, so you only got like 7 or 8 cigarettes in it. It was just like a very thin, wide packet. So I stole them. Me and my 3 pals at the time, we went. It was a lunchtime actually, so we met at lunchtime at the school, and then we went away from the school, and we went down to, we called it the Big Tree. It was down this path. So we went to the big tree, big massive oak tree, and they knocked it down to put a new doctor surgery in. I was gutted, man. I loved that tree. Used to play golf up to it as well. It was one of our holes. Anyway, so we passed round a cigarette each, and then we've got a lighter and we're passing it around, and it gets to me, and then so I light it. But the actual, I mean, physically, physiologically, I've no idea what I'm doing or what I'm supposed to do. And so it just, it's burning at the end, and then I keep on doing that, and then I basically start hyperventilating, then I spewed.
Yeah.
And then that was me. I went, nah, that's fucking shit. I'm never doing that again.
Yeah, it's the thing. Like, the thing is, I'm surprised being a musician you've not got into it, because that was the difficult thing for me, is, you know, just being around musicians. So many musicians smoke, and being outside after gigs and stuff like that. Like, yeah, I started when I was 20, which is young, but old enough to know better, really.
I'd say that's old for starting to smoke.
No, I know it's old enough to know better. That's too old.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean? But I'll tell you my favourite type of cigarettes are Chunghwas from China. Chunghwas. And it's like, it's Communist Party cigarettes. You can only buy them if you're a member of the party in China. You can't buy it, you know, because in China they're like...
Well, everybody, it's a single party state, so surely everybody's a member.
But you have to be like in the bureaucracy, I mean.
Right, and, the Politburo.
Yeah, and like they use them as bribes, because like bribery is illegal, but they have like, but they get around it by saying like they gift cigarettes to people. Instead, they give a crate of cigarettes to somebody, and they treat cigarettes like cigars, and they're the most expensive cigarettes in the world, but that's not that expensive. And it's like, and they're so nice, so smooth, and it's what Chairman Mao smoked. And I had a pack of them, and I had them. They used to be my after dinner cigarettes.
Right,
and they were really so smooth.
Have you been to China?
I've never been to China. My friend Paddy was in China, and I'd seen a YouTube video about it one night in a YouTube wormhole, and I asked him to bring me back some. So he brought me back.
So you brought them back.
Yeah.
Chairman Mao. So what was that? What was that? John sang Cursor Walter Raleigh. He was such a stupid get.
Yeah,
because he brought the tobacco back.
Exactly.
Happiness is a warm gun. A few comments came in there. I think Agley was saying that she loves Zoolander, or I don't know, Blazing Saddles.
Yeah,
Agley, let us know, what did you love, Blazing Saddles, Zoolander, or the Pink Panther movies, or maybe all of them?
Maybe Scum. Don't think so.
Or Scum. I don't know if that reached Venezuela and Caracas.
The recommendation.
Yeah, they're great. They are great. Mary Phillips, thanks for coming back. Mary's been on quite a few shows. Mary lives next to the sea, and you were singing about Mary and the sea.
Yeah.
Petty Kirby, good song. It was a good song. I'll give that video link a share in the comments too. Did you see the video about Bach there that it just rolled onto before I came back from tea making?
That was interesting. Yeah.
Isn't it just? I do find it interesting sometimes, like even after our songs, the way the YouTube algorithm works, like the random stuff that it will play after. But that was interesting. There was some. I was almost going to just let it run on for a wee bit longer just to see what they were saying.
One of the worst things about YouTube is because it's just your mind gets full of like because of these random videos you suggested. I remember I was on a date once, and the last said, "So what are you interested in?" I went, "The Aztecs." I was interested in the Aztecs because I've been watching a big Aztec documentary. I ended up like talking to an hour about like bloody Aztecs, you never believe it. Jeez, the Aztecs are amazing.
Here's another synchronicity. I did my standard grade art project on the Aztecs.
Yeah.
I was absolutely fascinated by Mesoamerican culture. Mm. It was why I went to Peru because I was so fascinated by the Incas. I primarily went to Peru to do an ayahuasca ceremony with Quechuan shamans, just in the foothills of the Andes, in this ancient capital of the Incan Empire, Cusco, in the Sacred Valley. That was basically life changing. We could talk about that for a long, long, long time. But see, the Aztecs. Have you been watching any of? Do you know who Graham Hancock is? Wrote Fingerprint of the Gods.
No, I've not watched any of that. Is that like History Channel stuff?
Well, probably I mean, he might have had something. I've not owned a TV since 2012. So I basically just get my content online or books nowadays anyway, or have done for the last 8 years. But Graham Hancock has an incredible ancient history, but ancient civilizations sort of journalist, writer. I mean, he's actually, I'll tell you exactly who he is. He is the modern Indiana Jones, and this book that he brought out called Fingerprint of the Gods, I'm going to drop it in the YouTube comments. Graham Hancock, Fingerprint of the Gods, because I like, one of the things I love about this StreamYard software that we're using, that basically as our conversation is evolving and everything is then saved on the 23 Universe YouTube channel, and it stays in the comments on the Facebook /23Universe page and on the Twitch. So like, there's a catalogue of our conversation that you can go back to. So I've just shared the book link for that. But a good one to dive into, Peter, would be the Joe Rogan Experience, who is obviously the most people know, the number one podcaster in the world. Yeah. He's actually just signed a $100 million deal to completely move his Joe Rogan Experience podcast, everything, every single episode, all the content, because he does own that. And he's going to move it from YouTube to Spotify, and Spotify are now going to start streaming him first as video content along with music content.
I don't know, live move.
It's an absolute game changer. Well, it's actually, you'll have your reasons for that and tell me them in a second or two, right? But they paid Joe Rogan $100 million and their share price went up by $5.5 billion.
Yeah.
So they actually, they paid $100 million to make $5.4 billion.
Yeah. I'm a podcast, and I listen to podcasts on Spotify, and you know, that's the only place I listen to this podcast. But see, if they have videos on Spotify, then if it's just the same as YouTube, if it ends up just being the same as YouTube, the only thing that makes it different is it is music. So I think they should make another app or something, because what's the point then if it's exactly the same as YouTube? It's gonna take away what's kind of special about it.
Because it's all about, I mean, capitalism is about the control of capital and the control of products and services and the control of the creation and the products and services. That's why we are the working class and you have the capitalist class, because they control what the working class produce. So even at a level of Joe Rogan,
I bought this today, funnily enough.
Is that a berry?
No, it's a wee communist hat.
Oh, right, very nice.
I had a little insignia on. You like it?
I do, actually. I like it. I've got something similar as well in my bedroom through the wall.
Came in the post today.
From a political ideological standpoint, are you a commie? That's not an accusation.
I would say I'm a socialist, yeah. I'd say I'm a socialist. I wouldn't say I'm a commie.
Me too. I've got a wee socialist star there. Which I got because of Rage Against the Machine.
Mm.
Let us know in the comments, what are you, everybody tuning in on tonight's episode of the 23 Podcast Show, episode 11 with Peter Johnson out in West Lothian. What are you? Are you a socialist? Are you a communist? Are you a Jedi? Are you a Marxist? Are you a Trotskyist? Are you a capitalist?
Yeah.
What's your ism? You don't need an ism. It's cool not to have an ism, but we're interested. Let us know. Aglaé, obviously Hugo Chavez, was...
Not a nice guy.
Ended up, I mean, in the beginning, though, it looked as if he was doing some good things for socialism. And then, like, next door, you had your two first indigenous leaders, Bolivia and Ecuador. I've forgotten both their names now. Evo Morales was the first. Now, one thing that I really do admire what Morales in Ecuador did is they actually gave, so they call Mother Earth Pachamama. They gave Pachamama the same legal rights as a sentient Ecuadorian citizen, which allowed them then to take, you're talking about the oil industry, this is again very synchronous, they took one of the major oil companies, American Texan oil companies, to court because they were basically fucking poisoning swathes of the Ecuadorian Amazon. It was disgusting.
Yeah.
And they won. And also, the Yankees, through the Washington Doctrine, when I say the Yankees, I just want to make something very clear now and on the record to the 23 universe and everybody tuning in. Nationalities and countries and labels and borders and all that, it's all fucking bullshit, right? We're all just one Homo sapiens species that have overpopulated. No, I take that back. We've populated every continent that we possibly can and as much of the world as we have at the moment, up to the point where we're now at 7.7 billion people. However, Bill Hicks summed it up perfectly for me. So he was out in Australia. Bill Hicks is my all-time favourite comedian, philosopher, prophet. And he had this thing that he would say in his skit. So he was out in Australia. He's finished his show in Australia. He's at the bar, as he does. He's knocking back his whiskies. Fucking a couple Australian rednecks, as he called them, which obviously Australia has their rednecks as well. They come up and he's like, so, boy, we listened to your show. So you're American then, yeah? He went, well, that's what my passport says. He went, well, we don't like Americans. And then he went, well, do you know what? I didn't have a choice where my parents fucked.
Yeah.
And that's it.
Yeah.
That's it. So you can criticise. To criticise a state is in no way racist whatsoever, because you can criticise what Westminster illegally did with the second war in Iraq.
Yeah.
That doesn't mean you hate your own country. You're self-loathing. You can criticise... Exactly. You can criticise Israel for bombing the Palestinians and their ethnic cleanser over there. Similarly, what Evo Morales did in Ecuador. So when he was having the court case, and obviously like the military-industrial complex have the backing, the revolving door, and have the complicity of governments and stuff like that, and the president of the USA at the time, maybe Boy Bush in his second administration. So he's putting a lot of pressure through their foreign office on Ecuador. And then they were saying something, one of the first things he does was he banned, he just asked the US to close down their military base in Ecuador and get out. Now, the US have, almost every country in the world has a US military base. And so Evo Morales turned around and he says, well, I'll tell you what, I'll make a deal with you. If you want to keep open your military base in Ecuador, then let Ecuador have a military base in Miami. What do you think the answer to that was?
No. Was it yes?
Exactly. No. Yes? It was no. So
yeah.
He kicked him out quite right too. I agree, it's a sense she also loves Mars Attack. Patsy's a peace-loving hippie, so are we. Peace, love, look after one another, one love. I think I might have said to you, Peter, there were a lot of synchronicities in the introduction from Neil when you mentioned the 23 Universe page. And the reason why the 23 Universe is called the 23 Universe is because of an album just over my shoulder.
Yellow Submarine.
Which I'm just about to show the graphic. So on the cover of the Yellow Submarine, being as massive a Beatles fan as I am, look beneath the arrow. Can you see that?
My brother's born on the 23rd of September. So there you go.
There you go.
And so now, was some other famous people. I think Michael Jordan as well.
Michael Jordan, he was my favourite basketball player. Probably my favourite sportsman of all time. I used to play a bit of basketball when I was younger for one of the first sort of semi-pro teams in Scotland, the Cumbernauld Chiefs. I was a centre guard when I was younger. Obviously not a slam dunker, because I'm only 5.
I had a moment of glory in the basketball pitch.
You what?
I'm not a sportsman, but I had one moment of glory.
A three-pointer from downtown. No,
I don't even know the name of it, but I was so bad. I'm not very athletic. I'm really clumsy, and I was in the basketball team just because I needed somewhere to go after school and the whole whatever. I just was there, and the teacher said, "You're rubbish, Peter. What you need to do all day is just practice your shot. Practice your shot. You're not good enough to play in the games. Just practice your shot. Practice your shot." Right? We're in the semi final. This is like when I was like 11. Then in the semi-final of the West Lothian Cup for all the schools, we're all doing it. And it's the last minute of the last game of the semi-final. And I was brought in, the teacher went, "You go in." And I scored the winning basket that brought the team to the next round. But my little brother is a basketball player. He was playing. He was saying, "Aye, we didn't win that year though." And then he went on to win it the next year. That he was the team, but that was my wee moment of glory. Yeah,
good on you. Good on you. I like that. That's cool. My best basketball moment as well is that we were playing a game. It was for my first high school, Christen High School. And whenever we played, so because I was just probably better than most of the other sort of kids in the year, I used to play with the teachers and their basketball team, which was great for my development because it really accelerated that as a boy playing with men. It was harder and challenged me more than all the rest of it. So we were playing a game, and just in when we had our basketball class, I would spend the last sort of 5 minutes just constantly practicing my three-pointers from my own half. And we had this game, so we were two down. We were two down about 10 seconds in the last quarter.
Yeah.
We had the tip off. The big guy who was 6'5", who won the tip off, he tipped it back to me, and I just got it. And from my own centre circle in my half, with the clock running down, the last shot of the game, I threw it from downtown and it went right in. No rims. That was us. We won by 1 point because of
time down in that. There's nothing like it.
Oh. It's beautiful, man. You're just in the zone there. 23 is a very interesting number. Now, I had Gavin Mitchell on the show last night, who's more commonly known as Bobby the Barman and Scotland's most successful and longest-running comedy series, Still Game, who also sold out 55 nights at the Hydro. 55 fucking nights at the Hydro, man. That's incredible. Over the last few years. Sadly, now finished. Gav's a huge supporter of the music scene here. Biggest David Bowie fan I know. Took me along to meet David Bowie's band one night when they played in the Academy. That was amazing because I also do love the Starman. And Gav went and recommended a few things. I'd asked him to recommend on lockdown. So when he came on, the three things that have been helping Gavin Mitchell get through lockdown, one is on BBC Sounds, which was a BBC Radio 4, which is a story about when the KLF burnt £1 million on the Isle of Jura. So it's a six-parter, They talk about the number 23 in that quite a lot because it's quite significant in their backstory. Without going too much into that, I won't bother because it is a massive, massive backstory. But I'm going to share in the comments the BBC Sounds link for that. I would definitely advise you to check it out. It's a fascinating story. I mean, a band who in 1991 were the highest selling singles act in the world, beating Madonna, everybody at the time. They had their famous four singles from the White Album, the one and only album that they brought out, then deleted. What Time Is Love, 3M Eternal, Last Train to Transcentral, and then Justified and Ancient with Tammy Wynette. He also recommended Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, an ode to joy. And Gav was also friends, pals. He lived in New York for a bit with Elliot Smith. So he recommended the Figure Eight album as well. And then he also read a beautiful poem called Survivor by Roger McGough. But when I got up this morning, I blew away my cobwebs listening to Beethoven's Ninth before I contacted yourself. And then I just
clockwork orange one.
Say again.
European, yeah, that's the European anthem, is it?
I know to joy, yeah. Well, it's from the
like classical music guy.
I know to joy was up. Okay. I like a lot of it, I have to say. If you would have told my 16-year-old Oasis supporting self that one day I would admit to loving classical music, I would have spat in your face. Yeah. But I wasn't really.
Classical music for me is, as I say, I inherited all my granddad's records. He was a classical music fan. And I'd listen to it. I think, you know what, this is all right. And I realised I had it on the wrong speed. I'd listen to it, wow. And it was the wrong speed. And I was like, I was like, oh, that's great. I love that. Then you listen to it, it's like, you know, it's good as well. I like when I come in, when I'm hungover on a Sunday morning, it's nice to put on something. And that's the only time I listen to classical music.
Nice. Well, on that six-parter for the KLF, it got to the point where it was talking about they said 23 is the most powerful number in the universe. Each parent contributes 23 chromosomes to the start of human life. So as far as we know, although Graham Hancock on that Joe Rogan Experience and his book, Fingerprint of the Gods, that there's obviously like the interventionist theory that ancient civilizations were visited by aliens, and that's who gave us a lot of our technology. In actual fact, like this, kind of like the common consensus, even with water on our planet, which potentially carried microbial life, which began the process of evolution to where we are, water came onto our planet as it was a fiery ball. And comets and the tail ends of meteors and comets and stuff like that. So, I mean, water itself is an alien, but here it is. The human physical biorhythm is naturally 23 days. 23 is the bandwidth of the message that was sent into space in search of extraterrestrial intelligence on, was it the Saturn V that they sent that out on, with the gold disc and stuff?
Discovery or something.
Yeah, that's the one. So, yeah, very interesting number, 23. Just jump through a few of the comments here. We've got somebody, Don Blackbird, came through from Twitch. Twitch is an interesting one, Peter, on this, I've noticed, because if you've got a Twitch account, you can basically just go on it and see who's live. So we've had people coming in, like an Iranian in Amsterdam and somebody in Brazil. You've just stumbled in, Don. Hello.
Yeah.
Welcome. It's not a parallel universe, it's a 23 universe. Scotland does have a professional basketball team now called Glasgow Rocks, which Gaz Penders, who first commented, he's one of the coaches for them. So I've just given that a share in the comments as well. So if you don't believe us that Scottish basketball is a thing, Don, let us know where you're from, who your basketball team is. Aglaé was saying socialism never works, sadly, is very utopic. Well,
she's from Venezuela, she has experience of it. I don't leave it at that.
She does. Yeah. She does. Yeah. We don't need to go down a political wormhole. Yeah. But I suppose one of the things that you can say, Lord Acton himself said that power corrupts, absolute power corrupts, absolutely. The only religion we have, actually, I think I've still got that graphic, even when it comes to politics and religion, Frank Zappa, one of my 60s, 70s counterculture heroes, Frank Zappa said one of the greatest things, in my opinion.
There you go.
There we go. Just take that away. Just take that away just now.
Frank Zappa. Never got into Frank Zappa.
He's class.
I like the guy. I like the guy and I like his interviews. But I've just not... like. It's just too... his music is too different. It's just too vast. And I mean, you don't know where to start.
Yeah. I know.
You listen to one song, Frank Zappa's like, I listen to that song, and it's completely different.
Aye. I mean, he released over 50 albums. His output with the mother, what solo with the Mothers of Invention was something else. Aglaé was saying there, the new music video of Lady Gaga is insane. I've not seen it. Sadly, I wouldn't be able to show it just now on this either because we get shut down when we had Medicine Men on last Friday. YouTube shut us down because Medicine Men, who released a new... Do you know the band Medicine Men, Peter?
I think I've heard of them. I've not listened to them.
Great band. The last headline gig we had in the Barrowland Ballroom, December 2018, our Christmas gig with Stanley Odd, Medicine Men were playing. So good pals with him. I'll give their Facebook page a share in the comments. You can go and check them out. So they released their second album, A Different Port, last Friday. We had them on and we were talking about their influences on the album. And they mentioned, do you know the Australian band Empire of the Sun?
Yeah.
Do you remember their song Walking on a Dream?
I think so. Did you show the video, right? Or something?
We played the video and I didn't know that because like there were Warner's YouTube have obviously got a license and agreement and stuff like that. So we're fine playing videos, but it kind of that was good to learn that. So I got an email from them the next day. They deleted the video. They let me challenge it. And obviously because I didn't have the copyright, they says, well, we'll snip it and just take that out and then we'll give you the video back. So that's what they did. But Aglaé's birthday is on 3 days. Any idea what I can do on quarantine? Well, in 3 days, Aglaé, you can come back and join us in the 23 universe. I can even bring you onto the show. Actually, are you connected with Aglaé? If you sent her the link, we could bring Aglaé into the show now if you wanted to.
Aglaé on to say hello.
Do you want to bring her on?
Yeah, sure thing. That's how it was. Can we put the music video on in the meantime, my next video?
Yes. Right. Tell me what that is.
Ball call sky.
Ball call sky.
Ball call.
I'm not really hearing the first word too clearly.
B-O-G.
B-O-G.
Hall. Ball call sky.
Ball call sky.
Yeah.
Got it. Yeah, got it. Okay. So, what we're going to do, Aglaé, and everybody that's watching, we're going to get our first podcaster joining us from Venezuela in Caracas on the other side of this video. This video is 2 minutes 57, so it's a wee bit longer. So, I'll mute. Peter's going to send Aglaé the link to join in and hopefully we'll get Aglaé on backstage and then another side of this video for Bog Hall Sky. We'll talk about that. Then we're going to go on. We're going to talk about some of the other creative projects that Peter's involved in. He's doing a documentary about Vincent van Gogh and he's also got a new zine that he started up which is called Slush Poppy. So we'll talk about that on the other side. I'll just take away Aglaé. You're about to come in. Okay, so I'll just mute us and then play that, and I'll over to you, Peter, to do the link sharing. Nice one.
You don't, we drank Tennent's once. You said it was the best thing that you ever drunk. Then again, you hadn't been drinking for months. And Glasgow's very nice, a bit like Portland or Washington State. I wouldn't know, I've never been down that side of the world. And there's something different in a bog hole sky. I've always quite liked it, but I like it more tonight. And there's something different in a bog hole sky. Will it be the same in the morning when we say goodbye? I showed you the place where I went to school. It was nice to see it through your eyes. Maybe if I knew you when I went to school, would it be less like Lord of the Flies? And there's something different in a fog hole sky. I've always quite liked it, but I like it more tonight. There's something different in a fog hole sky. Will it be the same in the morning when we say goodbye?
And we're back. We're back. Mary was loving that song as well, Peter.
Thanks, Mary.
Is Bog Hall also West Lothian?
Yeah, Bog Hall is a housing estate in Bathgate, at the back of Bathgate Hills, and I think it's great. I went to school in Bog Hall, and it feels like such a time capsule because it was all built in the 60s. And when you look at photographs from the 60s, everyone's got different hairstyles, but it's exactly the same.
Right.
You could feel like asking Hutch up there. It's great. Right.
I've just given the YouTube link for that video a share as well. It'll be in there. Everybody that's tuning in, you can go back. Please give Peter's YouTube channel a subscribe as well. That would be great. And as we've been talking about it before, I'll just bring back Peter's Bandcamp link to the bottom of the comments there. If people have just come in and joined us, check out Peter's music on his Bandcamp. He's also on his Spotify as well, but Bandcamp's the best place to.
And also I'm on Amazon and all that stuff as well. Amazon and Apple Music and whatnot and stuff like that.
All disreputable online digital retailers.
Yes, that's right.
Wait, how do you?
Generous.
They are. They pay us musicians lots and lots of money. We should be eternally grateful for the service that they provide. Eh? So, what's your main way of consuming music nowadays?
I'm actually a new convert to Spotify, and it's I feel like such an old man because I'm always saying like, you heard of Spotify? Like, isn't Spotify amazing? And it's been around for years, you know. But I'd never used it. But I love making playlists now. I had an iPod for much longer than I should have, because I'm a real hipster, proto hipster.
What kind of iPod?
It was an iPod Classic. It was the iPod that they made them with like 100. You could get 100,000 songs on it. Yeah. But then they made them with less, so you wouldn't. I don't know why Apple decided to do that.
Yeah.
Made them less. I like vinyl and I like cassettes as well. I like cassette tapes.
Cool.
But
do you still have something you can play a cassette tape on?
No, I don't. I've got a Walkman upstairs, but I never use it anymore.
Right.
I just got frustrated by cassette tapes getting, because they're quite temperamental.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I've been creating a couple of playlists as well. So maybe on the other side of this lockdown, Peter, just see if I've got the graphic. So from Warren Capaldi was actually booked to play one of them before we get shut down. But before, and Lee McGilvery played one as well, because a lovely, we got on really well. Do you know Barra's Art and Design, the venue behind the Barrowland Ballroom?
You know, I've seen it from the outside, I've never been in.
Right. It's a cracking venue. I'm actually just going to share a wee exclusive just now. Obviously, that's another venue that like every other live music venue, had to close. But from the 26th of January, every Sunday evening from 7-ish onwards, I was hosting a Sunday session, we called it, mostly acoustic. And an open mic as well. We had some amazing artists come through and play it. And I've just had sort of like permission from the owners of it because I've now got this platform. Saturday night there, I had a bit of a test run and bringing six musicians in total, in and out, three at a time, to go just round, and then we were playing songs with one another. So the format of the Sunday sessions was this. So tomorrow night, what I'm going to do from Sundays onwards, with maybe an exception to the rule, but Sundays onwards from tomorrow will be from 9 till 11. We may well change the time. But we're basically going to start tomorrow. From tomorrow, the Bar is Art and Design Sunday sessions online. And that's the lineup that I've got. And it'll be getting broadcast, streamed live from the 23 Universe. So maybe a future one we could get yourself on to play.
Absolutely.
Once we're back into the real world again, I'd love to get you through. It's a paying gig as well, so I'd love to get you through. You get a free lovely meal from the Ashaltain award winning fish restaurant within the venue. Free drink.
Some Welks.
You can get some Welks from the Barra's Market. You most definitely can. The Barra's Market is well famous for them. Remember, we were talking backstage before we came on in the virtual green room. Did you tune your guitar? Are you able to give us a wee live song tonight?
Maybe if there was another break. I've not tuned it yet.
Right. Okay. No bother. Well, we can think about the next video to play. So yeah, I'd definitely like to get you through for that. So what I'm about to share in the comments is, like yourself, I love I'm just going to share my screen. I love a playlist as well. So for everybody that played, the bar is art and design, and for those who didn't but were actually booked to play it, there we go. Can you see that okay?
Yep, I can see that.
So we've got 41 songs on there from a selection of the acts that played. So I am going to share the Spotify link.
I've got a playlist. I'd like to, whatever the word is. I've got a playlist.
I was just about to ask you what yours is, and I'll give you a follow. Mary's Fine. Saying thanks for the links, and she loved the playlist. She sent me, well, this is the one that I've just shared there. And then I've got another playlist, but you tell me yours, please, Peter.
I've got one called, I think it'll be on my Spotify. It's called Gigs I Wish I Was At, and it's all my favourite bands that I play with. Flew the Arrows on it, Hayley Beavis is on it, Life Models on it, Peter Katz on it, Ryan Morecambe's on it, lots of fab acts are on it, and so I think it's a good mix. I've enjoyed listening to it.
Okay, let me just check and make sure it is this, which I'm fairly certain is, but you can tell me.
That's the one, yeah. Ed Kid, amazing band, Ed Kid from Bathgate.
Okay. Right, so how do I follow that? Did I just go to create and follow you? Right, that's that, got that. And just go back, and I'll just copy the link. So there we go. We've got an amazing Gigs I Wish I Was At playlist with 11 songs over 36 minutes from Peter there. I've just given that a share. So give Peter a follow. Also, Peter, if you're okay and with your permission, the more playlists that you're on, then the better it basically helps your own sort of like algorithmic rating on Spotify. So what I've been doing is I've started... We're on episode 11 now of the 23 podcast show. So what I've started to do is share my screen again so that you can see this podcast show playlist. And so you can see some of the last acts there that have been on. With your permission after this, I would love to add you to that as well, if that's okay.
That'd be excellent. Thank you. We appreciate that.
Brilliant. Okay, I'll get that done after this. So that the 23 podcast show playlist is obviously going to be an evolving playlist and growing after we have each individual guest that comes on the show. And even when we've had some random guests who've came on that have been in the comments that we've actually just brought in, because I can actually get six people on the screen here maximum with the StreamYard software. So we've just been getting some extra like random selections and stuff like that. Well, actually, in fact, here's something for those in the comments. Between Peter and I, we'll be the adjudicator. But I will add the best song that someone comments in the comments to the 23 podcast show playlist. Well, it's now from episode 11. We'll make it interactive. So I'll add, for example, Peter's will get added to it. And then whoever we decide nominates the best song of their choice in the comments, I'll also add that into the playlist as well. Bearing in mind, it's got to be in Spotify in the first place, but excuse me, most folk are obviously on Spotify nowadays anyway. So moving on, I'd like to... What do you want to talk about next then, Peter? Your zine or Vincent van Gogh?
Let's talk about Vincent van Gogh because his face is there, and while his picture's on the screen, I will transform into Vincent van Gogh. There you go. This is me. See that? This is the hat I got to look like Vincent van Gogh.
Peter, has anybody ever said you look like Vincent van Gogh?
Often. That's right. Actually when I knew that that Ed Sheeran wasn't famous anymore, wasn't as big anymore. I don't know, or maybe we'll move to the West End or something, and people started yelling Vincent van Gogh from cars rather than Ed Sheeran. That's when I knew things had changed a bit. Maybe it was the beard.
Right.
But I've started making a short film about Van Gogh. One thing always struck me is the way that Van Gogh's portrayed in films. I've got bipolar disorder as well, and Vincent van Gogh had that. And I remember, like, when I was first diagnosed, you were given a list of famous people that had bipolar disorder, and that was to make you feel better. But they all killed themselves, all these famous people, and they all lived miserable lives, you know. So I thought I wanted to kind of address that, and I don't think Vincent van Gogh did have a miserable life. If you read his letters from his brother, it's just most of the letters just about him hanging out, like feeding chickens and painting all day. And he was completely funded by his brother to paint all day. And he was living in the south of France. So he had happy times. It wasn't all miserable for him. So that's what I want to show. So it's, the film's called A Happy Day in the Life of Vincent van Gogh.
I'm just going to put that banner up there, which I just created. So we'll leave that up there. Just so you know, this is what Peter's working on at the moment. And Peter, until yesterday, due to a cancellation that I had by my art, again, just all very synchronously, my artist friend, Marcus Reynolds Hislop from the Notorious Gasoline Company, that 23 podcast logo that you can see in the...
Yeah,
the top corner there, and over my shoulder. My pal Marcus designed that for me, which was based on a sketch that I made. This might sound like quite pretentious, like to say it, but I woke up from a very powerful. I'd been meditating before I'd went to sleep, and I was in. So Peter's been very open there with the mental health issue that he has in bipolar disorder. I've had mental health problems that I've been very open with throughout my lifetime as well. Struggled with depression, was diagnosed with depression and anxiety. I was on sertraline for a while, got myself back off it. I've had, just like everybody, like we all have physical health, we all have mental health. Within the spectrum of good to bad, we can all have good and bad days. And let's not forget, on a global level right now, we are in one of the most challenging time periods of most of our lifetimes. It was very difficult for me because as a musician and someone who works in the Barrowland Ballroom, my life basically just was, my future short to medium term life was ended. It was an unprecedented, very sudden end. I went through the five stages of the grieving process, from the bargaining to the, shock, bargaining, anger. Then April was just a complete depressed write-off where I was just struggling to get out of bed. I was in bed for like mostly 23 hours of the day. It was actually through watching some podcasts, Joe Rogan Experience with Graham Hancock. Are you familiar with a podcast animated show on Netflix called The Midnight Gospel?
I am indeed. That's what I shared on my Instagram. I shared a picture on my Instagram saying, I'm on a podcast tonight and I had a picture of The Midnight Gospel. So funny you should say that. Yeah.
There you go. Well, I've actually been able to get away, strangely. I think Netflix are obviously quite keen for you to advertise what's on Netflix. So there's a short 2-minute trailer for The Midnight Gospel. Are you cool if I pop that on just now to let those watching it? I mean, it was a catalyzing moment watching Duncan Trussell's.
I'm going to start watching it at midnight.
Good show.
Because I've been watching in the middle of the day and I've just realised it would even be better at midnight.
Yeah, because it totally, that's what I've been doing. I watch an episode before I go to sleep. If I get a meditation in, then I watch that. And it completely takes over your subconscious through your sleeping state. Unfortunately for me, in one way, I've developed insomnia throughout this month. So it was weird. Like, I came out of depression. This podcast show that I'm hosting just now was actually something that I started last January, February, March, April. It was on, but we used to film it live in the Barrowland Ballroom. We would film live performances and we would interview people in the famous dressing room one. But then it went into hiatus, an extended hiatus stroke hibernation, because festival season took over. I was at 20 festivals from May to September. We didn't bring it back, but through being inspired by the Midnight Gospel, the Joe Rogan Experience, my pal Mark McGee starting up his own podcast called You Call That Radio, my pal Colin Hunter starting up an amazing podcast on Spotify called My Battery's Low and It's Getting Dark. All of them just went to me, right, the only way I'm going to pull myself out of this depression is through creativity and connecting with new people and reconnecting with people that I know and getting this platform, which the software, once I got my head around it, it was pretty easy to operate. So we're going to share another shared love of Peter and myself's.
And Mr. Ben.
Will it be available on YouTube when it's done or different platform? Nicky, do you mean A Midnight Gospel or this podcast show? I know you're on Facebook just now, yes. All right, sorry.
You've not got Netflix, do you, Nicky?
Maybe she means your Van Gogh documentary.
Yeah. I'll be I'm not still deciding. I'll be finished when it's done.
Peter will let us know. And as I say to every guest on the show as well, Peter, I'm more than happy to continue promoting your stuff if you want to just give me a nudge, anything like that. Yeah, she did mean the Vincent one. Okay, we'll come back to that. Right, so let me line up the Midnight Gospel trailer.
I think you'd love it, Nicky. Well, you've not got Netflix. Shame.
Well, if she's got Spotify,
you can listen to
Duncan Trussell. Have you listened to Duncan Trussell's Family Hour?
Yeah.
Well, what will do for Nicky is I will share Duncan Trussell's Family Hour. Duncan Trussell has also been on the Joe Rogan Experience. He's one of the top guests Joe Rogan has had on that, because Joe absolutely loves him, and it's totally understandable why. So Nicky's exposed for lack of Netflix. Nicky, actually, here's the thing, right? I pay for my Netflix, but you can create multiple profiles on your Netflix account and give other people access to it. Only two people can access it at the same time, though. That's the only downside to it. So if you know someone else with Netflix, Nicky, I just want to remind people that this is coming up just to the end of the Mental Health Foundation's Mental Health Awareness Week, and the focus for that this year is kindness. So if you've got pals who have Netflix, Nicky, then let's hope they'll be kind to you and share that with you. But you can...
I've offered, you know.
She knows that. Okay. The offer's there, Nicky. So I've just shared the Spotify link for Duncan Trussell's Family Hour anyway, so you can check that out. But wow. Hold on to your psychonautical seatbelts, people. Strap yourselves in, buckle up, because we're about to be fired out of a spacecaster's literal vagina out through the universe into a different time and space. We'll be right back in 2 and a bit minutes.
Merging with simulator in 3, 2, 1. Which universe will you choose today?
My name's Clancy.
Clancy!
Could I interview you for my space cast? Are you worried because it seems like we're all about to die?
Is that a yes?
What does death look like to you?
I think we need to simplify this.
Your life that you thought was real was just a dream.
Holy shit. You a metaphor?
Stop fighting it. Face the void.
Just be here now.
Okay, cut to commercial.
Bush, we're back. We are back. Let us know what you thought of that midnight gospel. Trailer in the comments. Peter, I think you've muted yourself. I can't unmute you.
There you go.
Oh, you're back. You're back. Yeah. Okay.
I won't be able to stay much longer.
No bother, mate. That's fine. Just let me know if there's anything else that like you want to just quickly rattle through. I'll shut up. Nicky was saying that trailer is what the inside of my head looks like. I've just shared the trailer.
I believe it, Nicky. Nicky did the music video with me.
Yes.
Very creative artist, just got into Glasgow School of Art. Congratulations,
Nicky. Okay, before you play that song, I'm just going to quickly share your Facebook page for your musicians page, and I'm just going to quickly share your Slush Poppy zine
I'm here.
Page
I'm here as well. A one-off special edition of the zine. The zine is originally, and as usually when it's for sale, it's on Rizo. It's Rizo printing blue. It's everything's blue in it. That's it. But this is the original, I don't know how to describe it, prototype. This was the original prototype.
Do you fancy sending me one, please, Peter?
Yeah, of course. I'll send you one along with a CD. And the next one's coming out. I'll see if I'll show you some of the work in progress. So I'm doing... I'm doing vinyl cuts for the thing. This is going to be the next cover.
Oh, he's hit his button again on his phone. Mary, you're not too sure about the Midnight Gospel, still trying to digest it. There is a lot to digest, but it's worth it. And he's back.
This is a world exclusive. This is the cover of the next zine. And we've got some fantastic writers in it. We've got my favourite, hopefully again, I've not asked yet, but hopefully my favourite vegan restaurant, Serenity Now, is having a recipe in it, as it did in the last zine. My favourite record store, Some Great Reward, are writing their favourite record and what it's like in quarantine. One of my favourite bands, the Just Jones, are writing in it.
Easy, Nicky, easy.
Easy, oh. And this is the cover. This is the cover.
Nice.
You know, and this is one of these Italian, you know, these wonderful Italian ice cream shops you get in Glasgow that I just love.
There's Andy's giving you a nice wee comment there, saying you've got a nice smile. You're right, Andy. He does have a nice smile. Andy's a lovely guy. I hope you're well, mate. Big love to you, Andy. Peace.
Thank you.
Okay. So, yeah. What do you quickly want to run through then on the home straight? You tell me what's
the... trying. Tell me if you think this guitar's is too much out of tune. Or could I even leave for a few seconds because I can't use my tuner and chart? Yeah, I'm going to leave for a few seconds.
And then there was one. So just to let you know, tomorrow the 23 podcast show will be having a little bit of a rebrand. And tomorrow we are relaunching the Bar is Art and Design Sunday sessions online. They ran from Sunday the 26th of January up until we had to close down before the lockdown. And tomorrow night we've got a fantastic lineup of ignore the 24th of January date. I know that's wrong. I need to correct that. So we've got either side, Robin Ashcroft and Connor Fife. Robin is 16, Connor is 13. Probably the two most talented teenage musicians in Scotland right now. Incredible musicians, songwriters, lyricists, singers, voices are amazing. Robin sounds like Lady Gaga. Connor could go stadium level as far as I'm concerned. In the middle there, John Rush, Cheggy from the Rare Experiment, two other amazing artists who I also manage through my 23 music management. I'm going to give a share in the comments for John Rush's video, which was filmed in my spiritual home and workplace, the Barrowland Ballroom. It's a beautiful black and white video, also filmed by Peter's video director for Yoko Ono, Neil McKenzie from Keep It Creative. There's a lot of synchronicity in what we do. So go on, check out the John Rush video, please. And I'm going to share a video by The Rain Experiment. They're a phenomenal four-piece band. Kind of remind me of a cross between Blossom, Sam Fender, Catfish and the Bottlemen. They've got a very lovely psychedelic video for Be My Angel, which was made by my 23 promotions partner, Andy Anderson. So check them out there in the comments. Peter's waiting. Peter's backstage. Peter's back.
Oh.
So Peter's back. We can hear you okay.
Oh. So I'm going to play.
We've got another. Andy's feeling a wee bit rubbish tonight. Well, hopefully. As a wise scouser once sang, Andrew, all things must pass, including emotions. Tomorrow's a new day, mate. Let's hope Peter plays a lovely wee song here that will warm our cockles for us. But keep your chin up, mate. I know it's tough times out there, but keep your chin up, please.
Keep your chin up, Andy. This one's for you. And this song is about how this is about a time that seems so like a different world where you could go and go to the pub with your pals and stuff like that. This is about that. This is about, remember a few years ago, I was living in the West End, and we had the snow was everywhere. It was the heaviest snow I've ever seen. And everyone got off work, and everyone just went to the pub. And it was like going into a third world country. I'd never seen empty shelves. But now when you go into the shops, it's like that. And it's not as scary. It isn't like, oh, what's that like? This is the songs like that. And it's about missing my friends.
Okay.
Snow is nothing special when you come from Romania. Just like Dracula is not scary when you come from Transylvania. But Louisa could light a cigarette during the blizzards. And I must say, that was the best thing I saw all winter. The train lines were down, and there was no milk in the shops. No one could get to work, so we just went to the pub. My friend Sophie was happy, so it was her last exam and it got cancelled. When we walked home from the pub, the snow was up to our ankles. The snow is nothing special if you come from Romania. Just like Dracula is not scary if you come from Transylvania. But Louisa could light a cigarette during the blizzards. And I must say, that was the best thing I saw all winter. Then the summer came, and it was the hottest day on record. And the newsman said, it was the hottest day that Glasgow has ever had. Much too hot for me, I just stayed in and sat in the bath. The sun is nothing special if you come from Romania. And don't you know that Dracula is a folk hero in Transylvania? Thank you.
Let's have a round of applause in the comments, please, for Peter's lovely song there. What was the name of the song, Peter?
Christmas in Transylvania.
Christmas in Transylvania. Is it available anywhere online or anything? Or is it just
next EP? That's on the next EP.
We're on the next EP. Okay. Yeah. I'll just quickly rattle through the comments. I'll finish up at my end with this. A piece of a Yoko instruction for life and art from her seminal book Grapefruit. Mary was saying, looking forward to Sunday sessions. I've listened to John and Connor and loved them. Interested to hear the other artists. You will love them. We've also got a special guest who's going to be joining us from the Highlands, which the power of the internet can allow us to do. Andrew, hey David, you're brilliant. Thank you very much, mate. See you liked the John Grant at the Barras. Boy George and John Grant, Katie Tunstaller and Tim Burgess on Tim's listening party on Sunday night tomorrow. Cheers, pal. Well, I might not catch all of that. My wee pal Mandy plays bass with Katie. We played with her before at Big Burn Supper. She's lovely. John Grant's class. Obviously, I'll be at the Barras gig now that it's been moved, John Grant, to next year. I probably won't be on the listening party, just in case you missed it there, Andrew, because I'm hosting our new Barras Art and Design Sunday sessions online. So I'll be on that, but enjoy Tim's Twitter listening party if that's your thing, by all means. Who else have we got? There's Andy saying, great thanks, you're welcome, mate. I'm not sure what that is, I can't see. Lots of love there for your tune.
Thank you.
Best wishes Thank you, Andrew. Best wishes to you. Mary, brilliant song. Well done, Peter. Thank you, Mary. It's very kind of you. So, as I started last night with Gavin Mitchell, because we ended up getting talking about KLF and the Beatles and Liverpool and Yoko and all the rest of it, I started at the start with this, but as I picked up there, and as Yoko was dancing to your song, Peter,
yeah,
my eye was drawn to her instruction on the back. So tonight's instruction by Yoko Ono is from the back. And the back says, let me get up close. Let me get fixed and into position here, into my reading position. Tuna fish sandwich piece. Imagine 1,000 suns in the sky at the same time. Let them shine for 1 hour. Then let them gradually melt into the sky. Make one tuna fish sandwich and eat. Thank you, Yoko. Imagine. And good night from John. Get John and Yoko on the screen. There we go. Yoko, hey Yoko, Yoko, where we go for dinner? Are you making me a tuna fish sandwich? Are you making me another tuna fish sandwich for dinner, Yoko?
Melting away.
That was my best John Lennon impression. Yeah. Andrew was saying that was great. John's a very interesting performer. He is. Bravo. Oh, muchas gracias. Muchas gracias. Virtual. Yeah, I'll bring in a virtual hug, Peter. Come on.
There you virtual go. Group hug. Everybody, all of us listening. All of us
together. Everyone in the
universe. Right.
All across the universe. Okay. Peter, thank you very much. Is there anything just after this then? I'll give your Bandcamp a share again. Why not?
If everybody listening could follow me on Spotify, that would be a big help. That would really help.
That's fine. The last thing then I'll put in at Peter's request, I'll share his Spotify link there again as well, just for his own music. He's got some amazing songs. I've been listening to them all afternoon. Total earworms, very catchy. Peter, I love what you're doing, mate. Keep me posted with the development of your Van Gogh. I'll be in touch with you. I'll get one of your zines as well, and I'll be in touch with you about the Sunday sessions as well. So, Peter Johnson, thank you
for having me, man. Thanks for having me. Peace out.
Peace, love, and
love, white peace, as Spike Milligan would say.
The 23 podcast show. Okay, so thank you and good night, people. Hope you enjoy the rest of your night, whatever you're doing. I'm away to make another green tea, get myself comfortable. I'm going to watch another, I'm going to watch some more of the Midnight Gospel. We've still got some people on. Andrew, thank you very much. You're welcome, Andrew. Mary, group hug. And Agley, we were trying to bring you onto the call. Trying to bring you onto the podcast show. From my end, I wouldn't have been able to do it. But if you're commenting in the YouTube comments, then let me see if I can just copy that in just now. So if you want to give me a wee Spanish lesson, Aglae, then let's see where the comments are. Okay, Aglae, if you're still on, I've just posted, I've shared the link into YouTube. I don't know if you can see that. Let me know if you can see it. Good night, Andrew. Hope you're feeling better tomorrow, mate. Tomorrow is a new day. Just whilst you're on, Andrew, one thing that really helped me in terms of moving on through like the grieving process with this, I discovered this thing here, which is a model. And who do I want to be during COVID-19? So it's quite important to recognise where you're at with it. Are you in the fear zone? I grab food, toilet paper and medications that I don't need. I think we're most of us hopefully past that. I spread misinformation related to fear and anger. I complain frequently. I forward all messages I receive. I get mad easily. Or are you in the learning zone? You start to give up what you can't control. You stop compulsively consuming what hurts you, from food to news. You identify your emotions. You become aware of the situation and think how to act. You're evaluating information before spreading something false, because there is a lot of misinformation and lies out there, particularly by the Tory propaganda machine. You recognise that we are all trying to do our best, which we are. And then hopefully if you're moving from the learning zone into the growth zone, you start to think of others and see how you can help them. You make your talents available to those who need them. That's what I'm trying to do. You live in the present and focus on the future. Again, you're empathetic with yourself and with others. You think and appreciate others. You keep a happy emotional state and spread hope. You look for a way to adapt to new changes. And you practice quietude, patience, relationships, and creativity. And when I discovered that at the end of April, that also reframed a lot of my thinking and really, really helped me, as did reading more Bill Hicks. We are the facilitators of our own creative evolution, and that indeed we are. So whatever creativity is inside you, I mean, if you are locked down on isolation, I mean, I'm mostly home for about 23 hours of every day, have been for 10 weeks tomorrow. So I've had to go inside to facilitate my own creative evolution. You're now seeing the results of that. You're now a part of the 23 podcast show on the 23 universe. And it's through this that I'm looking to connect with other creatives, other like-minded souls, finding the others, and having a good time, putting smiles on our faces, reminding ourselves that we are the lucky ones throughout this. If we are home, we are healthy. We have food in the cupboards. We can connect with people. We can enjoy music. We're still mentally and physically active. Can do a lot of the things that we used to do, get out, do some exercise. We are the lucky ones when we think that in this national time of unprecedented crisis and pain and suffering for so many, tens and tens of thousands, probably over hundreds of thousands of people have sadly lost their lives, and many more have been affected by this. So let's not forget that. And let's remember that Mental Health Awareness Week is about to end. The focus for this week is on kindness. And we need to continue to be spreading kindness. So we need to be kind first and foremost to ourselves. And we need to spread that kindness outwards, because kindness isn't an apple pie. You don't eat a slice of it and then there's less for anyone else. Likewise with love and hope. All these positive emotions that we really need more of at this moment, kindness, love, hope, we have these in an infinite supply and we can spread them to other people. So let's continue to do that. That's good. Andy, I know you're a cheery wee soul. Keep that going, mate. Trying to make my friends and family lives better and being constructive. All good stuff. Hola, Aglie, buenas noches, dulces sueños. Andy, watching how I speak to people, trying to give people a kind word. Again, mate, great, good on you, keep that up. Aglie was listening while painting the room. I hope you've done a good job painting your room. Going to sleep now, have a good evening. Muchas gracias, cariña. Buenas noches, dulces sueños. Nos vemos mañana y mañana y mañana. Ala Ora, Noebi. Yes, Andrew, there's happy memories that we can all remember, and we'll get through this, Andrew. We will get through this. I've received some very positive news in terms of gigs and festivals recently, which is kind of off the record at the moment. But things are happening. We've got, in Scotland, we have a phased plan now to start reopening things and start getting the economy fully back. So keep the faith. Keep the faith. Living in Scotland is a blessing during this crisis. It really is. Keep the faith. That's good, mate. You're in the best place. You've been 20 years. Really pleased to hear that. Riley, Gary, shared. Thank you. Gracias. De nada. Amigo. Muchas gracias. A ti. Okay, so on that note, the time now is 23:25. You'll know I like my numerology. So on that note, I am going to wrap up tonight's show. Hopefully see you back here again tomorrow night at 9 for the Sunday sessions. Robin Ashcroft, John Rush, Cheggy from the Rain Experiment, Connor Fife, special guest Kenna Ross from Gordon James and the Power, who's going to be joining us from the Highland. And I'm going to sign off by saying peace, love, and the 23 podcast show. Good night. Take care. Stay safe. See you tomorrow, hopefully, or another night.